So let us quickly turn our Bibles to the book of Isaiah chapter 43 and let us read from verse 10. You are my witness, says the Lord, and my servant for whom I am chosen, that you may know and believe and understand that I am he. Before me there was no God formed, nor there shall be after me. I am the Lord, and beside me there is no Savior. I have declared and saved, I have proclaimed, and there was no foreign God among you. Therefore you are my witnesses, says the Lord, that I am God. Hallelujah. Here clearly the word of God says in Isaiah chapter 43 verse 10, the Lord is saying that you are my witnesses, says the Lord, for who I am chosen. Hallelujah. That you may know and believe in me. So today, one thing you need to clearly understand, that you and I on this planet earth, we are a witness for God. Hallelujah. Why we are witness for God? For what God has done in each one of our lives. The word of God says that he has saved us, he has called us with a holy calling, not according to our will, but according to his purpose. Hallelujah. So today we are here to be as a witness for God, to be a witness for Christ. That's where, wherever we go, we must never deny our identity in Christ. We need to stay as a witness for God. Hallelujah. That's what even in Acts chapter 1 verse 8, the word of God says, when the Holy Spirit shall come upon you, you shall attain power and you shall be a witness for me in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the entire world. That's what even Jesus Christ told the disciples before he can go to heaven, before he can ascend into heaven. He says that the Holy Spirit will come upon you and you will be a witness for me. Today, my brother and sister in Christ, we have to be witnessing for what God has done in each one of our lives. Hallelujah. Why we have to be a witness? Because we lived in a perverse and a crooked and a evil and wicked generation. That's what Jesus Christ also mentioned in the gospel. He said that we live among the people. Hallelujah. And that's where even the word of God says that in Matthew chapter 5 verse 14, the Bible says that you are the light of the world. Hallelujah. So you are the light of the world. And what he says, that we must reflect the light. Hallelujah. Because Jesus Christ said that I am the light of the world. So here in Matthew chapter 5 verse 14, you are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden. If you read verse 16, see what does the word of God says in Matthew chapter 5 and verse 16. Hallelujah. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good work and glorify your Father in heaven. Let your light so shine. That means do not hide your light, but you let it shine that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. And today God has called each one of us that we may testify, that we may be a witness in Christ. Wherever we are, we need to be a witness to our brother, we need to be a witness to our sister, we need to be a witness to our relatives, to our neighbors, and even to our staff where we work. Hallelujah. He wants us to be a witness, and we must never ever try to deny our identity in Christ. That's what the disciples, wherever they went, they always carried Christ along with them. Hallelujah. When you say you are a Christian, it's clearly you need to understand that you need to show your identity in Christ. Hallelujah. Many people, you know, nowadays they are ashamed to call themselves Christian, because they will think that they may offend the staff, or they may offend their relatives, or they may offend their friends. But the Bible clearly says that we must not be ashamed to declare. Hallelujah. Because see what God is telling in the book of Luke chapter 9 and verse 26. Let us read what the word of God says in Luke chapter 9 and verse 26. For whoever is ashamed of me and my words, of him the Son of Man will be ashamed when he comes in his own glory and his Father and of the holy angels. He says, whoever is ashamed of me, of my words, of him the Son of Man. That's why we must never be ashamed for what Jesus Christ has done in each one of our lives. That's what we see in the life of Paul. Paul was, before you look at the life of Paul, he was a murderer. He took letters from the scribes, he took letters from the Pharisees and from the elders, and he wanted to persecute and he killed many Christians. But after his transformation at the road of Damascus, God is telling that he is a vessel chosen by me, and that he must go into the world and preach the gospel. Hallelujah! So that's way we can always see that Paul always remembered for what he was. Hallelujah. Even today, my brother and sister in Christ, before we come to know Christ, our lives were totally different. We lived like however we like. We lived like the heathens. But God chosen us from the womb of our mother. God has called us. Hallelujah. Amen. Among your family members, God chosen you. Among your relatives, amongst your neighbors, he has chosen you. Why? Because there is a great plan and the purpose. Why? Because Jesus Christ demonstrated, he paid the price for you and for me. Instead of you and me dying on the cross of Calvary, he shed his precious blood. Hallelujah. And today he wants you and me that we may be as a witness for God. Wherever we go, my brother, my sister, in whichever country we live, does not matter. We need to be as a witness. We need to be a testimony for Christ. Hallelujah. That's what the word of God says, that you are the light of the world, and let your light shine among the people, that they may see your good works and that they may glorify God in you. Hallelujah, my brother and sister in Christ. And that is very much a important. That's what even we see when God called Jeremiah, according to Jeremiah chapter 1 verse 7 and 8. See what does the word of God says clearly in Jeremiah chapter 1 verse 7 and 8. But the Lord said to me, do not say I am a youth, for you shall go to all to whom I have sent you, and whatever I command you, you must speak. That's what the word of God says clearly. He said, do not be afraid of their faces, for I am with you to deliver, says the Lord. So Bible clearly says that God doesn't want us to be ashamed. You see, that's what the word of God says. I am sending you among the people, and you need to go and you need to declare for what the Lord has been doing in each one of our lives. That's what's very much important, my brother, my sister in Christ. And that's what, that's where even Jesus Christ said in John, the Gospel of John 15 verse 16, he says, you have not chosen me, but I have chosen you that you may go and that you may bear fruit. Hallelujah. The question is, when God has chosen us, are we bearing fruit? Are we doing exactly what God has chosen us to do? My brother and sister in Christ, we need to examine our hearts. Because you know one thing, the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ is at hand. Anytime from now, the church can be raptured. And what is the only one question that Jesus will always ask you? Did you go and tell about me to the world? Whoever you came into contact. That is the only question he will ask you. He will not ask you how much money you made, what building you lived in, what car you drove, what type of a British passport you have, or what type of passport, how much money you accumulated in this planet Earth is not a question. He says, did you go and tell your neighbor? Did you be as a testimony to your neighbor? That's what I think clearly you need to understand. Or are we going to tell like how Cain said, am I my brother's keeper? You see clearly when we know that when Cain murdered his brother Abel, God came and asked, where is your brother? He said, am I my brother's keeper? No, we are our brother's keeper. We need to reveal Jesus to even to our neighbors, even to the place where we work. We must never deny him, because the Bible says if you deny him, he will also deny you, my brother and sister in Christ. And that's what's very much important. Today the Lord has put, and that's what in Isaiah 43:10 he says, you are my witness for who I am chosen. God looks upon you, God looks upon me, my brother and sister in Christ. And that is very, very much important, to do the will of God and to do what God has called us to. That's what the disciples also did. After the day of Pentecost, when they received the Holy Spirit, they went into the streets of Jerusalem declaring about Jesus Christ. They said, how can we not declare of the person who we lived with? We saw his death, we saw his resurrection, we saw his crucifixion. And they said, how can we not speak of this man for what great and mighty things he have done? My brother and sister in Christ, today that's what Jesus Christ said, that you will be fishers of men, he said them. Why? Because one day will come when you will have to preach the gospel. That's why in the life of Paul, after his transformation, you know one thing, he went and he preached the gospel. God separated him from the gospel clearly. We see in the book of Romans chapter 1 and verse 16, the word of God says, I am not ashamed of the gospel, clearly he says, clearly. My brother, wherever he went, he says, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it's the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, for the Jews first and also for the Greeks. He says, I am not ashamed of the gospel. I am not ashamed to declare my identity. Wherever he stood before the Sanhedrin, before he stood before Agrippa, before he stood before even Felix, everywhere he went, he testified. He gave a, he testified of what God has done in his life. My brother, my sister in Christ. That's what clearly you need to understand, that wherever God takes you, you must not keep your mouth shut, but you must speak about Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Why? Because the Bible says that when one soul is saved, the angels in heaven, they rejoice. That's what God rejoices when we speak about him to the world. When we give Jesus, we are coming close to Christmas. What is Christmas all about? Christmas is nothing but giving Christ to them. Hallelujah. Christmas is not about Santa Claus. It is not about turkey, cooking of turkey or doing other things. Christmas is about Christ. Are you able to give Christ to your neighbor? Hallelujah. Are you able to give that indescribable gift which Paul says? That's what he says. I thank God for that indescribable gift which God has given me. And what was the gift that was given to Paul? It was given to you and me and given to Paul, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. That's where God gave his only begotten son to the world. That's where Jesus Christ died for you and for me on the cross of Calvary. Hallelujah. And that's where we must always stand for God. Hallelujah. Wherever we may be persecuted, we may go through trials, we may go through tribulation. But one thing you must always know, that we must never deny him. Hallelujah. Peter also said the same words. He said, Lord, wherever you go, I will go with you. I will never deny you. But Jesus Christ said one word, before the cock can crow, you Peter, you will deny me 3 times. And it happened exactly as the Lord has spoken. My brother and sister, many times in our life we will think, oh, I will not deny Christ. Even at the point of death also, I will die for him. Many people will say those same words that what Peter said to Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. My brother, my sister in Christ. That's where we must stand in our faith. That's where the disciples, they were martyred, they were killed, they were hung, they were burnt alive because of Jesus Christ. But wherever they went, they spoke about Jesus. Even when they were hung on the cross, even when they were burnt alive, that did not stop them from speaking about Jesus. They were still preaching the gospel, even from that, even at the last minute of their death also, they still spoke the word of God. Hallelujah. My brother and sister, and they never feared death, because death could not separate them. Hallelujah. That's what you need to clearly, one thing from Jesus Christ, you know. That's where Jesus himself said, do not fear though to destroy the body, but fear though to destroy the body and the soul and take it to hell. They never feared their body, whether it was burnt, whether they killed them, whether they were martyred. They testified and they spoke. They said, only thing, we rather obey God than to do what man has said. They also told them, you better keep quiet, be silent. They were thrown into prison for the gospel. They were persecuted, they were thrown. But God did not leave them alone, my brother and sister in Christ. Even in the prison, we see that God showed up. And he showed up, and in a supernatural way, God has delivered them from every bondage, from the shackle, from the power of darkness, my brother. That's what today the Bible clearly says, that God has, the devil has blinded these people that they may not know, that they come to the truth clearly. That's what the word of God says clearly. Hallelujah. The gospel has to be preached, but the God of these ages has blinded them that they may not know the truth. Because the work of the devil doesn't want a person to achieve salvation. Because the greatest miracle is always salvation, my brother. Wherever they went, they preached about salvation. They preached about the remission of sin. They preached about repentance. Amen. Because that is only what God has told them to preach, my brother and sister in Christ. Wherever they went, they testified about Jesus Christ. Wherever they went, they testified about his crucifixion, about his resurrection. And great power was there in those meetings, my brother. Great revival took place in the streets of Jerusalem. We see that Peter, after his transformation, after his conversion, we can see preaching the gospel, and the heart of the people was convicted by the Holy Spirit. We see that in Acts chapter 2, verse 37 to 41. Let us see what happened exactly. In Acts chapter 2, verse 37 to 41. Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Next verse. Then Peter said to them, repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sin, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Next verse, clearly. For the promise is to you and to your children and to all those who are far off, as many as the Lord our God will call, clearly. Hallelujah. And with many of other words, he testified and exhorted them, saying, be saved from this preserved generation. Hallelujah. And verse 41, then those who gladly received the word were baptized, and that day about 3,000 souls were added. Thus way you must be led by the Spirit of God. That's what happened even to the house of Cornelius. The Bible says that Cornelius was a Gentile, but when Peter was praying in the upper room, the Holy Spirit said, it's time for you to go to the house of Cornelius. There are two people who are waiting down for you. Immediately, without delay, we see that Peter entering into the house of Cornelius, and he started to speak about the resurrection. He started to speak about the death. He started to speak about the crucifixion. The Bible says that while Peter was still ministering in the house of Cornelius, that the Holy Spirit fell upon them. They started to speak in tongues, and the Spirit of God gave them utterance. Why? Because the house of Cornelius had to be saved. You know, he was giving alms. He was doing a lot of charity. Many people say, oh, you know, brother, I'm doing a lot of charity. I'm doing a lot of alms. If you look at that, then Cornelius was better than you. Because God himself is telling to Cornelius. What God is telling to Cornelius? See, in chapter 10, verse 2 and 3, what does the word of God says clearly? Chapter 10, verse 2 and 3 in Acts of the Apostles says, a devoted man and one who feared God with all his household, who gave alms generously to the people and prayed to God always. This man also gave everything. But what this man lacked and his household lacked was salvation. My brother, my sister in Christ, clearly. We see here what happened. You know, he was nice. He was high. In the eyes of God, he was okay. In the eyes of God, he always gave charity. He was always generous. But your charity and your generosity does not take you to heaven. It does not qualify you to enter into heaven. And God knew that. So God, through the Holy Spirit, had to speak to Peter. And Peter, we see him ministering in the house of Cornelius. Because it was not only the household of Cornelius. Cornelius' relatives, everyone came for the meeting. And immediately, when he was still ministering, according to the word of God, if you see from 41, from 10th chapter verse 41, we see clearly that the Holy Spirit fell upon the house of Cornelius. Hallelujah. You see clearly. And that's what we see clearly. And then what they did, immediately Peter did not just be happy and said, oh, they are being baptized in the Holy Spirit. He said, who can forbid these people in being baptized in water? Hallelujah. See, while Bible says in verse 44, while Peter was still speaking this word, the Holy Spirit fell upon all those who heard the word clearly. Let's see the next word. And those of the circumstance who believed were astonished, as many as them came with Peter, because the gift of the Holy Spirit has been poured onto the Gentiles also clearly. Hallelujah. See, verse 46, before they heard them speak in tongues, magnifying God, and Peter answered. See clearly what the next verse says. Can anyone forbid water that these should be baptized who have received the Holy Spirit just as we? You see, while Peter was still ministering the word of God about salvation, because wherever the disciples went, they only spoke about the crucifixion and the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. There was no other gospel that they preached. Amen. And Bible says, while Peter was still speaking, he did not even lay hands. He did not even pray for them. But the Holy Spirit fell upon those who heard the word, and they started to speak in tongues. And immediately what he did, can anyone forbid water that these should not be baptized who have received the Holy Spirit just as we had? And in verse 48 we see that the household of Cornelius and all their relatives who were invited in the meeting, what happened? They were baptized in the Holy Spirit, and they were baptized in water clearly. Hallelujah. And that's what we see clearly, my brother and sister in Christ. That's what today God is looking at you. God is saying that I, you are testimony. You may be persecuted for the gospel, but you must not fear. Hallelujah. Many people were being persecuted. Many people have been killed for the gospel when they preach the gospel. But you must not fear. Hallelujah. Because God has promised us a better place for us in heaven. Hallelujah. That's what we look. Even when the Apostle John was seeing a vision which God showed them in the book of Revelation chapter 6. Let us see from verse 9 to 11. In Revelation chapter 6 verse 9 to 11. When he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who have been slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. Next verse. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Lord, holy and true, until you judge and avenge the blood of those who dwell on this earth? Then a white robe was given to each one of them, and it was said to them that they should rest a little while, long until both the numbers of their fellow servants and their brethren who would be killed as they were completed. Here we see they were killed for their testimony and for the word of God. My brother and sister, thus way persecution started even during the first century when the church was, when revival broke out in the first century, the church was persecuted. And all the disciples, they went far and wide to different parts of the continent. We all know that. And one of the disciples happened to come, reached to India. Some were in Spain, some went to Greece, some were in Macedonia, some were in Jerusalem, some were killed in Rome. Like Paul and Peter was killed in Rome. We see Thomas, he was killed. They were all killed because of their faith in Jesus. Hallelujah. But they never feared, because they know that heaven is a better place. That's what even Paul says in the word of God. He says, citizenship is in heaven. In Philippians chapter 3 verse 20, and then I end my message. In Philippians chapter 3 verse 20, see what the word of God says clearly. For our citizenship is in heaven, from whom we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. We are waiting because our citizenship is in heaven. Because the life in which you and I are living on this planet Earth is temporarily. He says our citizenship is in heaven, for which we are eagerly waiting. We are eagerly waiting, waiting. When? When can we go to heaven, my brother, my sister in Christ? That's why Jesus Christ in the Gospel of John 14:3 says, I am going to prepare a place for you, that when I come, that I will take, that you will be with me also, with my Father, my brother and sister. And today the Lord is giving us a great responsibility. And what are the responsibility that Jesus Christ has given to the church is the gospel. That we have to be a testimony for our brother. We need to be as a witness for our sister. We need to be a testimony for our neighbors. Wherever we are, we need to testify of the goodness of God, for what God has done. Hallelujah. You see clearly, wherever we go, we need to give glory to God and say, this is what God has done. Maybe through your preaching they may not get saved, but through your testimony they can come to Christ. Hallelujah. That's why today Jesus is doing signs, wonders, miracles. He's healing the sick. He's delivering those who are being afflicted by the devil. He's doing miracles. Why? Because Jesus Christ is no more in the grave, but he has risen from the grave, and today he is alive. Hallelujah. My brother and sister in Christ. And that's why today the Lord spoke to Isaiah 43:10 that you are my witness. You have chosen you. He says, are you ready to do my will? That's why when we see in the book of Isaiah chapter 6, God says, who will go for me? He gave an open invitation. It was a general invitation for everyone. And immediately we see that the prophet Isaiah responding to the call of God upon his life. He said, Lord, send me, Lord. I am ready to go. My brother and sister in Christ, are we like the prophet Isaiah who said, send me, Lord, I am ready to go and preach the gospel. Wherever I go, I will testify of what you have done in my life. That's what it is, my brother. We must not be afraid of what people say. We must never be offended by what people may think of us. But we must stand on a ground. We must know our identity in Christ. Hallelujah. We must know our identity in Christ. That is very much important. It's no use of calling ourselves Christians if we do not identify Christ in our lives, in what we do. And wherever we go, we must always testify of the goodness of God that God has done in our lives.